Okay. So, good morning. So, first, what is a renewal process? A renewal process is just a generalization of the Poisson process. So, if one understands the Poisson process fully, at least the technique and the concepts are there to understand what is a renewal process. So, Poisson process is what happens when you are waiting for a taxi at the airport. So, this is the number of taxis which arrive during the course of time. And suppose that you are at the airport and a taxi has just gone. Okay, so you don't count it. So there was a taxi here at the origin of time. And so you wait for some time, tau one, and the taxi arrives. Then you wait for another time, and another taxi arrives, and so on and so forth. Okay? So, this is tau two, tau three, tau four. And so you are here, and you observe the number of taxis which are arriving in the course of time during time zero and time t. And so this is a random variable n of t. Okay? So actually, this is the Poisson process, n of t. Sometimes people say that n of t is Poisson process, but I prefer to say that this is a Poisson process. Okay, so the distribution of interval between the arrival of two taxis is an exponential distribution. Lambda is the rate at which those taxis arrive, so it means that the average time between two taxis is 1 over lambda. And the number of events is given by the Poisson distribution. And it's obvious that in average, between 0 and t, the average number of taxis which are arriving is t divided by average t. And the variance too behaves like t. And it turns out that all cumulants also scale as t. As for independent IID random variable, hence the central limit theorem is satisfied. You see, the tau 1, tau 2, tau 3, tau 4, they are independent. However, there is a constraint, which is that you are counting the number of taxis arriving between 0 and t, which is a random variable. Okay? So nt equal n is the same as saying that t is between time tn so let us denote this time. And so here, I suppose that there is another arrival. So I will denote this one as tn and this one as t, sorry, tn plus 1. So if n is fixed equal to n, it's the same to say that there are n taxis or saying that t is exactly between tn and tn plus 1, where tn is the sum of the n first interval of time. So you write down that the distribution function, the cumulative distribution of tn minus tn, the distribution for tn plus 1, gives the distribution of the number of taxis. In Laplace space, it gives you this formula. And you see that actually I'm speaking of the Poisson process, but it's general for any distribution. Here, for the particular case, if you Laplace transform the exponential, you find this. And it's a little exercise to look at the large deviation function for this distribution, and you find this this curve. Okay? Other nice observable are Tn, where be careful, n here is a given number. I give me n as I want. And so this is sum of ID on the variable, okay? So for if I sum exponential variable, it gives me a gamma distribution. It depends on n and centered around n times the average. But if I look at the epoch of the last event, which is there, then you see that this is a sum of a random number of random variables, and it depends on t. Okay? Another quantity which is nice to look at is the age this one, which is the age of the interval which is still alive. And this one is the excess time, which is this time, the excess time after t. And of course, you see that at plus et is equal to the last interval, which is there. Okay? In the case of a Poisson process, meaning that the distribution of the time interval is exponential, it turns out that AT and ET are both exponential. So it's already something which is interesting, because if you add two exponential, if you take, for instance, the mean, you see that the mean of the mean of AT plus ET is two. It's twice the average interval. So this is called the inspection paradox, which is more general, actually. So another thing is the occupation time. So suppose that the taxi arrive at the airport, and at the last time, they are dispatched by a policeman, either to terminal A or terminal B, okay? So you say, you give a sign. If they go to A, it's plus one, and B, it's minus one. So you want to see what is the time spent positive or negative. For instance, here, you see that this one went to terminal A, this one also, and this one. So this is T plus, and T2 plus T4 is T minus, okay? The time spent to go on one terminal or the other one. And there is a more symmetrical quantity, which is the sum of those with the sign, which is the alternative alternating sum. Okay, so it turns out that the computation of the distribution is some work, and I don't show you the Laplace transform of this quantity, but you believe me, and what you find is this simple quantity in the case of a Poisson process. Okay? So this is the Laplace transform with respect to time. Time is always present in this problem, and x is the value of the random variable s of t. Okay? So if you look at the Laplace transform with respect to the random variable s, then you find this quantity, and this leads you to the computation of the large deviation function of this distribution, which is given by a semicircle, okay? In particular, if y is x over t, it is the fraction of time spent positive or negative, then this is exactly the same as saying that the taxi went all to terminal A or Yes, all to terminal A. So this is the probability that S of t is equal to t. Or the same is that they all went to terminal t. And this is exactly P0 of t, where P0 is the probability that there was zero event during time t. So that the first interval was larger than t. Okay, so the first cross after the origin was after time t, and this is the persistence or survival probability. Another thing which is nice to look at still for the Poisson process is the longest. Okay, so first, if you take again n ID intervals and you compute the max, then it's well known that it's given by the Gumbel distribution. Okay, so 2max is given up to this average, log n plus z of g, which is a Gumbel distribution. In average, 2max of n is log n plus gamma, the Euler gamma. Okay? But here we look at another quantity, which is the max of the interval between 0 and t, which is t1, t2, tau n, tau 1, tau 2, tau n, and a of t. And those intervals are not independent. But the result above still holds with n replaced by t over 2. So you can change ensemble, and it gives you a prediction, the right prediction. Actually, this is a claim. It's also what you can guess, because there is some rigidity between the number of arrivals and the time. But if you want to properly derive this, you have to look at the distribution, the joint distribution of all those variables. And this is given by, if this is a configuration, I mean the value is taken by those random variables, then this is the product of the n first one. There is a special, for the age, you have to look, you have to input the survival probability, and you put the constraint that all the interval should sum to t. Okay? So then you write, as usual, that the probability that the max is less than L is that all intervals are less than L, so you have to integrate, and so on and so forth. So it's not a big deal, it's a computation. So now let's come to renewal process in general. So the only thing to say is that the distribution of interval now, how rho of tau is arbitrary. Okay? So this distribution can be either narrow, meaning that the survival probability or the tail, if you want, of this distribution decays faster than any parallel, or a broad distribution where there is a tail exponent, where theta is positive, and tau zero is a microscopic time scale. So if theta is smaller than one, all moments of rho are divergent. If theta is between one and two, the first moment is finite, but higher moments are divergent, and so on and so forth. In Laplace space, you can write for small s, large time, s is a Laplace parameter conjugate to t, a decomposition on the moments of rho. For a broad distribution, if theta is less than one, so there is the distribution is singular, and if theta is between one and two, the singularity is longer away, and so on and so forth. So, what is interesting in this problem of Fresnel process? Actually, in statistical physics or math, they are ubiquitous. You find them quite often. For instance, if you look at Brownian motion and you look at when a Brownian motion or think of a simple random walk or a general random walk, whatever, where they cross the origin, think of a simple random walk crossing the origin, then between two crossings, precisely the length of interval is given by a broad law, with theta equal 1/2. in the statistics of records appeared exactly the same situation. But in physics, with, when you look at blinking dots and things like that, then it's exactly, you can model what happens with the renewal process. When you use the independent interval approximation, by definition, you use a renewal process. When you look at flipping spins, it is a nice approximation to use a renewal process to model the system and so on and so forth. Here we will focus on theta equal one, less than one, because it's the most peculiar, the most interesting, and also it occurs most often in physics. There is self-similarity of the process, as we will see, universal behavior with respect to the distribution rho of tau. In particular, each result that I will present for theta equal one half will be a result true for a random walk or in the continuum limit for Brownian motion. So this is a process, invented process, stochastic process in time. And you see that if you look at the zeros and the interval between zeros, there are the tau 1, tau 2, and tau 3, and so on. The last one is the age of the last interval still in life, and ET is excess time. So what I want to speak about for this general thing, general renewal process, is exactly what we have mentioned. So those observable that we already presented, the occupation time, the longest, and then I will speak about the Brownian bridge and what one call tie-down renewal processes. So N of T. So let us guess. T is a sum of T1, T2, and A of T. So this random variable, their number is, let's say, approximately N of T. So if you take if they were ID independent, then you know that the generalized central theorem says that for such a sum, the scaling of the sum is like the number of terms to the power 1 over theta, which is the index of the distribution of rho of tau, times x of theta, where x of theta is a one-sided stable law of index theta. One-sided because here I'm summing positive random variable. Hence, you can guess that n of t should be t to theta, x theta to the minus theta. Actually, this is true. It's what the computation gives. And for instance, for theta equal one half, the distribution of this quantity is a half quotient. The second quantity that is interesting to look at is T of nt, the epoch of the n event, and the age. And both are related with the sum up to T, which is a constant. So this computation gives essentially the generalization of what happens for theta equal one half, which is Brownian motion, if you want, and both rescale variable with respect to T, the scale like T, is an arcsine law, okay? For the excess, it's different. There is a long tail. And so when the theta is anything between 0 and 1, it's a generalization of this. It's called a beta distribution. Now, I don't want to go into the details. I just quote the result. I'm just making a kind of survey of what one can say about renewal processes in general. And so the occupation time, again, the scale like T. And so those quantities are distributed. Again, if theta is equal to 1/2, this is a well-known result, which is due to Levy, that the distribution of the occupation time, either of t plus or the alternating sum, is an arcsine law. But for theta less than 1, this arcsine law deforms and becomes the Lamperti distribution, which is essentially, for theta small enough, it, for instance, let us put the distribution of t plus divided by t. So for theta equal 1/2, you have the, oops, no. You have an arcsine law. And if you deform, if theta becomes larger than some theta star, which is 0.5 something, you have still this singularity here, but here it becomes, there is a maximum appearing which grows, which grows when theta increases. So this distribution is named after Lamperti. The longest. Again, can we guess the result? So it's what I call Darling versus Lamperti. Darling is a physicist or mathematician. He was more mathematician. And Lamperti is the same, but the Lamperti distribution I'm going to speak about is not this one, it is another one. So Lamperti was actually, I think, the student of Darling, if I remember well, and he was very much interested in renewal processes. So this is a heuristic reasoning for the distribution that you want, which is tau max t, which is, as we said for the Poisson process, the same. But now it's more complicated because we have got those broad laws. So again, let us make the following reasoning. Suppose that we give ourselves n. We say, I want to know after 25 taxi, what is the time spent? So tau 1 plus tau 2 plus tau 3 plus tau 25. Okay, but those are independent, identically distributed random variable. Okay, so there I know that the scaling, I mean this in distribution is given by n, it's scaled by n 1 over theta, x of theta, which is a one-sided stable law I mentioned earlier. On the other side, and you know that the max interval of those, tau 1 to n, is given by a Fréchet distribution once you have rescaled by n to the 1 over theta. So it means that if you make the ratio of Tn over T max n, this is expected to have a limit distribution. Actually, it is so. And this distribution was computed by Darling for IID random variable. And corresponding to this random variable, which is the limiting random variable, is the limit where the number of random variable interval goes to infinity. And so if we divide both, we find this. But be careful, one cannot compute this by saying that it is this ratio, but because those two are not independent. So the only thing that we can guess is that there is a limiting distribution, and actually this is the case, and it was given by Darling. And I will come back later on this distribution. Now, you look at the renewal process, and you make the following guess. You say again that n is equal to t theta. This is true, that we have proven, we have said that before, so this is true. But the idea is that we are going to say that n, small n, scales like that. Okay? So we replace n by t. So let us call this quantity t tau tilde, which I don't know what it means. It's a guess. It's heuristic. So you see that if you plug in the quantities that you had before this n, it will give you t zf over x. So it means that it predicts this heuristic reasoning that t divided by tau tilde and tn divided by the tau max n should be should have the same limiting distribution. But actually, we are interested in tau max of t. So let us define this quantity, v, and it turns out this is the result that w, the random variable of Darling, is distribution exactly equal to this one, which is quite funny. Actually, Lamperti wrote this paper later than Darling and did not notice it. It was noticed a long time later by Pittman and Yor, I think. So this is actually what those distributions look like. So f of v is this quantity that I mentioned, and r is inverse of v. So r is tau max of t divided by t. And so this thing and this one are typical of this kind of problem, which are that you encounter in plenty of problems, which is the longest in a situation where there is a long tail. For instance, this a long time ago that we look at in a totally different context. It's not the same problem, it's analogous by Derrida and Flüberg. For breaking sticks, or it was related to spin glasses and so on and so forth. And the peculiarity of all those distributions is that they have singularities, discontinuities in the derivative at each integer. Here you see the one at 2. After that, it's difficult to see with the eye. And here it's all rational. I've got a discontinuity. Here at 1/2, you see it. So this is representative of distribution of the longest in this kind of problem, much away from renewal, beyond renewal processes. Okay, coming back on this question of the longest, there is an interesting thing to say, is that there is a sensitivity to the choice of the last interval. So we have looked at this distribution, this sequence of interval, tau 1 to 2, the last one, tau n, here it's 4, 80, and we stop there. But we could have considered this sequence. We don't stop at tau 4, but we stop at the next one, and we look at this sequence of interval. Or we could just stop at the last one, t1, t2, t4, t3, t4. So this yields three definitions of a longest interval, which are here. And it turns out that if you compute this ratio, which I called r, for theta equal 1/2, you find those numbers here, this one, which was well known in the context of Brownian motion. This one is infinite in this definition, and this is due to the fact that this one can be as large as you want, because it's away from t, so it can be infinite. And the last one actually was not considered, as far as I know, in the mathematical or physical literature, and it's much smaller. There is another quantity which is nice, but I say just one word on it. It is the probability that the last interval of the sequence, 80, or this one, is the largest. So you see that those two are the same. Here there is a number that was demonstrated by Schaeffer, a mathematician, with very complicated method. Here it's quite simple. And for the last one, the scaling is not the same. So that's it. So in order to derive the values which are in the table, you have to write down the joint probability distribution. This one, you have already seen it. It's the first sequence. The second sequence has a different joint probability distribution. And so third one, again, and they are all related one with the other. If you, those are absolutely general for any distribution of intervals, so you can check with the Poisson process, for instance. And so what you find is that in the previous table, there are little difference, small difference. But those, it means that there is a weak sensitivity to the choice of last interval if theta is larger than one. This is true as soon as theta is larger than one, not only for the Poisson process. So the last topic I want to speak about is tie-down rendezvous, which are also called bridge rendezvous, or Bernoulli bridge, or whatever, Brownian bridge, and the associated Rignol processes, which I will name tie-down Rignol processes. So the idea is simple, that you are tied down, the random walk is tied down to a time t, this is time t, it should arrive at zero. Okay, this is a constraint. So in some sense, it is the fourth case. We had one, two, three, and this is fourth. It's a bit different. Okay. So what can we say about this thing, where now there is no AT? The age of the last one is zero. This is a constraint. So we want to know what we can say about the longest correlation and the occupation time. So let's speak about the random walk. It's easy to write down the joint distribution of a configuration. So now there is a two here because you see that in the ticks which are here are every two steps, okay? So I call this time, I don't call it t, it's an integer, it's 2n, okay? So in time 2n, so one, and mn is what I called previously n of t, I call it m of n, it's the number of interval that you had here. For instance, here, m of n is 5. So it's an easy, the numerator is simple, and it's what you guess, okay? You have to take the distribution of interval. There is a constraint, but you have to input the bridge condition. And the bridge condition is the sum over m and all the sizes of the interval of the numerator. And this is exactly the return probability of the walk at time 2n, which is a well-known formula, and you can check that if you make the summation here, you find this, where FL is the difference between those two return, sorry, UN is the return probability of the walk at time 2N, and so if you make a difference of two, it is the first return probability to zero of the walk at time 2L. Okay, so this is a random walk, but we want to go to the continuum limit, which I call tie-down Rignol process. And in particular, the Brownian bridge will be represented by theta equal 1/2. So the joint density of the configuration L1, Ln of the sequence of nt equal n intervals to 1, conditioned by this bridge condition, that the time of the last one is exactly the time of observation, has the same form as this one, except that now, I use the notation that I used before for the distribution of interval. This is not a Kronecker delta, but it's a Dirac. And U of t is what you guess, which is the sum of the numerator. Okay? Sum on n and integral on l. And if you do now the computation of the distribution of the longest, rescaled by time, it's always the same, what you find is, again, a curve which is singular at each integer or at each rational. And the average of this one is this number. But this reminds you of something that we have seen just before. It is actually twice this number. So there is a relationship between this problem, in some sense, and the third case. Now, we want to speak about correlation, two-time correlation. Actually, the setting is the following. T is the time of observation, but the running time is something else. The running time is this. And I want to know what happens between capital T and capital T plus capital T prime, where there are this number of events between the two time. And I would like to know about correlation for this. Correlation of what? Actually, again, I can associate terminal E, terminal B, or a plus sign or a minus sign, or you think about the sign of the exertion of Brownian motion. So it's plus one, minus one, plus one, minus one. And so the correlation I'm interested in is the correlation between two spins at time t and time t plus t prime, which is this quantity, or the sum of the it is the average of the sine of the parity. It's the parity of this, is the average parity. So one can do the computation, and actually, I don't know how to do the computation in general. I've got There is a big formula for in Laplace space, but if you want to invert, it's quite hard. I don't know how to do it, but I can find two regimes of interest. What is called the Poirot regime, which is small, short separation between time t and time t plus t prime. And then you find this scaling form. You have to compute the scaling function, and what you find ultimately is this formula, which is universal. The microscopic scale has disappeared. And this is to compare to an ansatz that Barma and co-worker did in the past, that they said that for exactly this situation, this Brownian bridge, in the context of stochastic evolving surfaces, where sigma was a sign of the position of the surface with respect to some level, they had this. So this is true, but you see that here there is an additional dependence with the scaling function. So this is the exact result. In the other regime, where there is a large separation between t and t prime, this is a persistence regime, you find another scaling function. And that's it. So let us move quickly to the occupation time of this process. So it's a well-known fact, I did not know it myself some times back, but I learned it, that for Brownian bridge, Levy showed that the distribution of the rescaled occupation time is uniform, which is not, at least for me, completely intuitive. It's not intuitive. So what is the distribution for theta less than one? And so you see that for theta less than 1/2, so 1/2 is flat. Less than 1/2 is again a singular curve, a curve singular at the two end. Here it's singular, but the singularity, the concavity is inverted. And so this is the result of a computation. In order to solve this, it's not so easy. One has to solve a generalized Stiglitz problem, and it turns out that this can be solved. For instance, you can check that for theta equal 1/2, f of x is equal to 1. Actually, the rescale occupation time has got an interpretation in a model of Barr and Mukamel, which is a spin model. You have domains, and you have a number of domains, and they add to the length, the total length of the problem. And it turns out that the Boltzmann-Gibbs distribution of this model is exactly the joint distribution that I gave you before, except that this model is in space, while for the bridge is in time. So the interpretation of this rescale occupation time is the magnetization at criticality. So let me conclude. What I wanted to show you is that there are simple and systematic methods to recover and extend results which are scattered in the mathematical literature, also in the physical literature. For physical question, as soon as you have an independent interval approximation, you can use this those methods. It's very secure, it's systematic. Initially, I was interested in this kind of problem because if you look at an Ising spin flipping at zero temperature, it's a very, very complicated problem, which is unsolved up to now. But you can approximate the flipping of the spin by precisely independent interval. I mentioned two physical applications, stochastically evolving surfaces and spin model with Langlands forces, and also in the statistics of records for the random walk or for many situations. Again, there is this renewal process which is underlying, and essentially the mathematics is the same. So some references, the flipping spin during coarsening, that was the thing that put me in the field. A simple model which would be able to reproduce some results that we can make, you can obtain by simulation. So after that, we wanted to understand systematically what happens in a renewal process. That was a systematic study of this. The longest interval is a paper that we made recently with Satya and Gregory. The bridge, which I mentioned is a recent paper. One was the longest, and the second one for the two-time correlation. And I mentioned the records just at the end, so just to make one references, there are many, by Satya in particular. This is a review. Thank you.
When you have the random walk and then you have the tie down condition, can you do like Brownian motion? You can condition the random walk and then get the effective process that gives you the tie down random walk.
What is the question then?
Can you do like conditioning like the Brownian process? Like
you mean practically?
Yes.
No, I mean there are things for that. I mean, I think for that, as a trick for that. But to constrain it, you mean, for instance, if you want to make a simulation or things like that?
Yeah, for instance,
yeah. The Brownian bridge we have. Yeah, yeah, for the Brownian, you can essentially, you have to subtract, it's BT minus T over something. Yeah, this, yeah, that's it. Yeah, it's yeah. There is a paper of Henri Orland Satya on this subject. Yes.
Satya, I recall you did something with Shamik about renewal process.
What? No, no.
More with the resetting of,
It was resetting, yeah.
Interfaces, basically. So that was, I mean, renewal process came as a sort of intermediate step, but that was more like a, if you have a fluctuating interface and you reset, once in a while to the initial condition, and then it reaches a stationary state. So, thanks.
Other questions? If not, let's thank Claude again.